So episode one of season six of Homeland was called Fair Game. I know some people didn't like it, particularly the portrayal of Quinn, but I thought it was an interesting episode and I am optimistic, albeit cautiously optimistic, for the fate of the character and also the Carrie Quinn relationship. You'll recall that when we saw Quinn last season, we weren't even sure whether he would survive. With the abundance of spoilers on Tumblr, we knew that he had survived, but in a much altered form. I hadn't been reading the spoilers in detail, but I did know that the writers were making it clear that he had been very adversely affected. Interestingly enough, our very first glimpse of Quinn is quite quintessential in terms of what he says.
Motherfucker.
I had wondered whether or not they were going to try to hand wave away some of the impacts of the sarin from last season. So I was impressed that they went there. It's pretty clear that Quinn has been very severely damaged by the effects of the sarin and the fact that Carrie and Saul woke him from his induced coma before his body was ready. So there have been adverse consequences as a result of that. His speech is impaired, his movement is heavily impaired. He looks like a very damaged individual.
Hey, just put my head right through the... Jackpot!
They definitely toy with us, though, because there's one moment where the guy who's robbing Quinn asks him whether or not he's got PTSD.
You got the PTSD? Could have.
Quinn's response is a little bit sarcastic, quite self-aware, suggests to me that even though his responses, both physical and verbal, are quite slow, everything's definitely still working in his head the way it's supposed to, and he's processing the environment around him. I don't know about anybody else, but part of me did wonder whether or not, when he was being robbed by that guy, he might strike back and the Quinn that we knew would suddenly make an emergence. But of course that didn't happen, and it was right that it didn't happen, but I think it was clear that they were making us wonder whether or not being held up would make the old Quinn resurface. I certainly was not expecting it, and so was not surprised not to find any hint of Carrie Quinn shipping in this particular episode. What I was a little bit surprised about was how devoted Carrie was. That we learn from Nurse Battitude that she's been visiting every day, which on the one hand is lovely because it shows how devoted she's been, and on the other hand it's quite unromantic because it's entirely possible that she's motivated by feelings of extremely profound guilt, which is not romantic, but is lovely in its own way because she's the one who says Quinn has no one. And she believes that she's there for him.
Look, I get it. Nobody hates hospitals more than me. You gotta help me out here, Quinn. I don't know what else to do. I can't take care of you by myself, and you won't let me put you into a private program, so this is what you've got. For now.
Bed's made. I rent it out. Airbnb.
How much? I can pay.
Quinn, that's not
necessary. I said I can pay.
Okay.
In that particular exchange, you can see that Quinn is still a very proud person. He doesn't want Carrie's charity or her pity. So you can see that's probably why he does not want her seeing him in this particular condition. I mentioned in my pic spam that there are direct parallels with the scene here where he's being taken away by the orderlies. And also the scene in episode 2 of season 3 where Carrie's being taken away by orderlies. So even though the moment where Quinn is grabbing onto Carrie and she says, let me go, and he says, let me go, is very intense. And I suppose a little bit depressing if you're a shipper. It does convey the fact that there's still a great deal of feeling between the two of them, and that there are strong emotional reasons why he doesn't want her around when he's feeling so vulnerable.
I know you're frustrated.
Oh, that's what you think. Okay. I'll go with that. I'm frustrated. Whatever you say.
The hardest time, when you can't go on one more second, that's when you have to keep trying, because that's when breakthroughs happen.
Fucking moto shit!
I know you want to get out of here, but you're not ready
you
yet.
Just stop! Being like a dog!
Quinn, listen. Just stay with it. You will improve.
All
kinds of progress will start then.
I'm not getting any better. Can't you get that through your fucking skull?
Let me go.
Let me go.
The show also uses nurse attitude to show us that it's very psychological as well. That when Carrie's not around, Quinn is better. That the Quinn that we see is not necessarily the Quinn that he is all the time. And he definitely has moments during the episode when he's clearly very, very lucid and responding to what Carrie says. For instance, when she tells him that she's brought him to her home, there's an entirely calm and rational Quinn who listens to what she has to say and responds.
I live here with Franny. It's our home, right upstairs. So don't bring troubled people here or do drugs or behave like you did last night.
There's something very wry and almost tender about Carrie when she tells Quinn that they're going to make it work. She says, we will make it work. And then she also tells him to have a shower, i.e. that he stinks. Dan and I were talking about the fact that he's probably incredibly grotty, hasn't bathed in days, is covered in prostitute juice, has been hanging out in that crack house. He's just gross. But she brings him into her home, and even though she has locked the door upstairs, don't forget, he is not a prisoner there. She told him that there's a door that leads out into the garden, so that means he can leave the house. The lock that she has on the door is not likely to stop the likes of Quinn. She knows exactly who he is and what he's capable of. And yet she has brought him into her home with her child. So clearly she still trusts him at some level, because she knows that normal suburban locks are not going to keep the likes of Peter Quinn out. But she has told him that this is my home, my child lives here, you need to behave. And he has agreed to that. So the fact that there's still a measure of trust is also quite interesting.
Tomorrow, we'll make it work. Quinn, take a shower.
The show is clearly showing us that part of the reason he has not recovered yet is psychological. And when he finds a reason to get better, he will get better.
Jean, you can't make people do things they don't want to do.
Perhaps it's not entirely realistic, but there is some validity in the suggestion that the power of his mind can motivate him to get better. This is also television, so as I mentioned in my pick spam, he will get better with the assistance of a montage. After all, that's how Nicholas Brody got over his heroin addiction. So that's Quinn and Carrie and Quinn. Some people have asked me about the dancing Quinn scene. I'm going to pretend it didn't happen, because that was just really weird and kind of upsetting. I don't think it deserved the name dancing. They're clearly just trying to show us that he's totally out of it. I am a little bit curious about the bright lights that he's seeing. I don't know whether he is hallucinating or whether or not it is as a result of the brain damage. It's really not clear. But twice in the episode we saw Quinn see a kind of glimmer of light. I'm really, really hoping it's not a reference to the glimmer that he mentioned in his letter to Carrie, because that would be too cheesy. So the next thing that I wanted to discuss was the character of Sekou Bah. They have deliberately picked a young, articulate man who is unthreatening in his appearance and in his manner. He is educated and he is articulate, and he has a righteous sense of indignation and anger. The show is clearly exploring the theme of some people being more equal than others. Sekou claims that he has the right to the protection of free speech, protected speech, but it's very clear to us as the viewer that because of who he is, where he's from, and the way he looks, he needs to be much more careful in how he expresses his political opinions, especially when they're quite strong.
I'm assuming a fair trial isn't what they're getting.
If you're male and Muslim, the conviction rate is pushing 90%.
I know a guy who was arrested for plotting to bring down the Brooklyn Bridge with a blowtorch.
He's doing 20 years in a federal prison, essentially for being an idiot.
Okay, you can stop selling. I've written the check already.
The introduction to Sekou Bah makes it clear that he has a sympathy for Faisal Shazad, a Pakistani-American citizen imprisoned for life for an attempted Times Square car bombing on 1 May 2010. Hence his line, "By 2010, Faisal Shazad was mad as hell and not going to take it anymore." So on the one hand, he has a deep resentment for American foreign policy and hero worship for its enemies, but he also naively and foolishly trusts in the protections of the US Constitution, namely the First Amendment to the US Constitution, which prohibits the making of any law that abridges the freedom of speech. It does a few other things as well, but that's probably the most critical one for the purpose of this episode. I think a lot of people don't think about the fact that although the US Constitution enshrines the right to free speech, there are a large number of exemptions to that right. But Sekou is essentially a naive kid, and he genuinely believes that he's just telling the other side of the story so that people can hear the truth.
By 2010, Faisal Shazad was mad as hell and not going to take it anymore. Mad about the town of Adita, where 24 Muslims, including 5 children, were shot up by U.S. Marines while they slept in their bed. Mad about Abir al-Janabi, a 14-year-old Iraqi girl who was gang raped by American soldiers. Then put a bullet in her brain and set her corpse on fire. There's two sides to every story, no man.
Since when is engaging in religious and political debate online a punishable offense?
Well, its intent is to motivate people to attack the United States.
Intent? Wow. That's a tough one to prove. What if he's just honestly opposed to U.S. foreign policy in Muslim countries, like I am more and more?
Do you keep photos of dead American soldiers on your laptop? Or provide links to sites where you can watch the latest suicide bomber?
Well, we just met with him, and what I saw was an angry kid at worst.
Oh, he's way past anger, believe me.
The thing is, that is the thing. There are double standards. Carrie, as the blonde former CIA employee, can say the things that she says without getting into trouble. Too much trouble anyway. Even Elizabeth Keane, the president-elect, states some rather unpopular beliefs that could, if expressed by a different person, have had her accused of being disloyal to America or of sympathizing with the enemy. You can see that Dara Dahl certainly doesn't approve of the things that she says, and neither does the senator whom Saul speaks with later on in the episode.
What about getting out?
Excuse me?
Leaving. Telling the American people this isn't working and bringing our forces home. All of them. Why not? If the war isn't winnable, what are we still doing there?
Containing the enemy, for one thing. Preventing them from turning the region into a base for attacking us here at home.
Or maybe it's time to recognize that not every problem in the Middle East deserves a military solution.
Reader Hashem couldn't be more clear in his meaning when he warns Sekou Bey about why others in his community may not have been quite as outspoken as he has been.
We took a look at your website, Sekou, and you've been openly critical of America and supportive of its sworn enemies.
I know what protected speech is. I can say what I want. I am not a violent person.
They'll try to make the case that what you're doing is inciting others to violence.
But that's not true.
The imam says you're a regular at the mosque. Tell me, when's the last time you heard a khatib speak to the congregation about Abu Ghraib, or Guantanamo, or drones, or torture? Now you know why.
The episode also contained an interesting parallel or reference back to episode 1 of season 5, in which Quinn, during a debrief, talked about potential strategies for dealing with the situation in Syria. So in this episode, General McClendon has clearly told the president that the only way to resolve the difficulties in Syria is to utilize a fairly strong military solution.
You know what General McClendon just told me? Put 70,000 troops into Syria and ISIS is done and dusted in 6 weeks. What does CIA think? Oh, don't be shy, gentlemen. Jump right in. This is a free fire zone.
Well, problem's not so much destroying ISIS, Madam President, as it is...
Madam President-elect. It's a mouthful, I know.
Madam President-elect. Bigger problem is holding and securing the territory afterwards.
So now it's a ground invasion and an occupation.
Otherwise, just another ISIS waiting in the wings.
You might recall that in episode 1 of season 5, Quinn was asked about possible solutions for the situation in Syria. His preferred option was a more humanitarian option. His second option, which was his non-preferred option, was quite similar to General McClendon's.
200,000 American troops on the ground indefinitely to provide security and support for an equal number of doctors and elementary school teachers.
Well, that's not going to happen.
Then I better get back there.
What else? What else would make a difference?
Hit reset.
Meaning what?
Meaning pound Raqqa into a parking lot.
The solution Quinn proposed last season, as his preferred option, had a strongly humanitarian element in it, which is why he wanted American doctors and elementary school teachers, as well as a military presence. The interesting thing is, while there was no appetite for his solution last season, I get the impression that Elizabeth Keane probably would be much more receptive than Quinn's audience last season. It's a common trope or saying that drone strikes create more enemies than they eliminate. Nabil Khoury, the deputy chief of mission at the US Embassy in Yemen from 2004 to 2007, said, "Drone strikes take out a few bad guys to be sure, but they also kill a large number of innocent civilians. Given Yemen's tribal structure, the US generates roughly 40 to 60 new enemies for every AQAP operative killed by drones. We saw similar things in relation to the way the US and its allies conducted war in Vietnam." So I'm wondering whether or not Sekou Bey's character arc is going to be something along the lines of his arrest by Conlon and the way he is treated may push him towards radicalization in a way that his own search for truth did not. He was already an angry and resentful young man who disapproved of American foreign policy, but he probably wasn't going to do anything more than just talk about it. Is it possible that the way he's being treated now may radicalize him in the same way that drone strikes can create an enemy? So I'm going to move off the political stuff. What about Carotto? We find out that Carrie is still working for Otto's Humanitarian Foundation, an offshoot in Brooklyn whose efforts are to provide aid to Muslims living in the United States. Otto Düring funds this. His past relationship with Carrie is very ambiguous. During season 5, you will recall that he told Carrie that unlike his earthbound first wife, he and Carrie both have wings. And then this season, he dismisses her efforts to help the Muslim community as being small potatoes.
I mean, here in Brooklyn with a bunch of kids and their associate professor. Small potatoes. What? That's the expression, no? Small potatoes.
Fuck you, Otto.
I'm serious.
So am I. It's important work. Law enforcement needs to stop harassing and demonizing an entire community.
Tens of millions of war refugees. More than a billion people living in extreme poverty. These are the issues you should be focusing on.
Well, I'm not. This is what I'm focusing on.
I was a little bit ambivalent about that particular exchange. On the one hand, it's a bit patronizing for him to dismiss something that Carrie cares about as being small potatoes. On the other hand, you could see that he was trying to encourage her to help more people. But then I start rapidly losing sympathy for him when he announces that he's met someone. So he's been propositioning her for the last 3 months. She's been saying no. He clearly doesn't take no for an answer. And now he comes to Brooklyn and makes a statement like, I've met someone. Carrie justifiably gets snotty and calls him on it.
I've met someone.
What?
Yeah.
Wait, what is this? Some kind of ultimatum?
No, I thought you should know.
You should go.
Listen, Carrie.
I'm not changing my mind.
And I'm telling you, you're making a mistake. You think you're better off alone. You think your sins are quiet, but they don't. You couldn't be more wrong.
I have to say that I'm with Carrie on this one. I think Otto is giving her an ultimatum. What else could it mean? He's thinking, so you've been saying no to me for 3 months, but now that I tell you I've met someone else, maybe you'll say yes. Because you didn't like me when no one else wanted me, but now that someone else wants me, maybe you will. Yuck. That also kind of sucks for the person he's just met and presumably has feelings for him. Poor woman. Maybe she's earthbound and wingless. Like a potato. Now I know that there are some people out there who are going to think that Otto was being all noble and caring when he said the following words.
Now go.
If it's not me, Carrie.
It's not.
Let it be someone else.
Seriously, he doesn't care about her. He wants it to be Otto. He doesn't want her to be with anyone else. If he genuinely cared about Carrie, he wouldn't have tried to sabotage her relationship with Jonas back in Berlin. I originally had the following as a video clip, but YouTube blocked it. It's a scene between Jonas and Otto in season 5 in the episode Aureole, where Jonas goes in search of Otto. Basically, Jonas says he's worried about Carrie. Otto says, me too, not just about her safety. Jonas asks him what he means. Otto then says he's worried about her mental state. He asks Jonas how long is our deal with her. Jonas tells him her contract is up in February. Otto then tells Jonas that we made a mistake in hiring her. He claims that Carrie is unbalanced and that he won't be renewing her contract. Then he says a bit bitchily, of course, don't let that influence your personal relationship with her. That's your business. So he is clearly trying to sabotage Jonas's relationship with Carrie. He is seriously full of total crap, because you might remember this was his proposal to Carrie at the end of season 5. Nothing in there about her being unstable, about being a bad choice of employee, about the fact that he regretted employing her.
So are you ready to hear another offer? I'd like to make one.
I can't go back to work right away, Otto. I'm sorry. Too much has happened. I need to take some time, be a mom again for a while.
Understand. But I'm not talking about your old job.
No?
No. You've trained your team well. Mike can take over.
What then?
Over the years, I've hired a lot of extraordinary people, interviewed a lot more.
You're picky. You're famous for it.
Never anybody like you, though.
It's nice of you to say.
It's not nice. I read your application, so right away how brilliant you are.
If Otto had really wanted her to be happy, he wouldn't have tried to meddle with the Jonas relationship. I know Jonas has his detractors, and he was a lot of a turd in the season 5 finale, but to be honest, until that point, his character had seemed pretty sympathetic. Red-headed, German human rights lawyer, compassionate. He looked after Quinn for Kerry. He cared about Quinn even though he didn't have to. He was actually a pretty decent bloke until the writers made him a bit caddish in the season finale. I'm not a Jonas fan, but I think that all of his reactions to what happened to him were generally pretty understandable. In any case, regarding Otto, last season I was willing to give Otto the benefit of a doubt, but this season I've decided he's a bit of a magnificent bastard. It doesn't mean I don't like him as a character, but I do not think he has good intentions where Carrie's concerned. He's quite selfish, and I think he's decided that Carrie's an object that he wants to obtain and possess, and she is remaining elusive, and she's probably a challenge for him. Finally, I wanted to touch on the characterization of Saul and Dara Dol this season. So far in this episode for Saul, they're clearly pushing for him to be the show's moral compass again, after he's been paddling in the baby pool of grey morality for the last couple of seasons. I think that there was enough Saul backlash that they thought it worked better when Saul was characterised as a good guy rather than a morally grey guy. So this season we have him expressing more moderate views than Dara Dol.
Bring the troops home, complete the pivot towards Iran, demilitarize the CIA.
What I heard was a newly elected president auditioning a bunch of new ideas.
I don't know, so she gave us very little love today.
She'll learn to love us.
I'm not sure where all this rosy optimism's coming from, but I don't like it.
Keeping the country safe is big business right now. It's getting bigger.
Now, don't you start, Saul. There's a reason that we haven't had another 9/11. It's called vigilance.
Hey, I'm all for vigilance. But you know as well as I do, there are no coordinated ISIS or Al-Qaeda networks here in the United States, like there are in Europe.
Yeah, because we've been kicking ass and taking names.
All I'm saying is she's not entirely wrong. Where she is wrong, she's persuadable.
I think that the show has decided that the estrangement between Saul and Kerry has lasted long enough, and it's probably a better combination when those two are aligned, which is why I think Saul is probably going to get a more sympathetic character arc this season. In contrast, Dara Dol continues to be a rather extreme caricature. Unlike a lot of the other major characters, he doesn't really seem to have layers. We know he has a soft spot for Quinn, but otherwise he's kind of a classic moustache-twirling villain. A dark plotting spider spinning his web of intrigue and evil.
I think she despises us, Saul. I think she blames us for her boy. I think she intends to hold us all accountable.
In that last particular statement by Dara Dol, I can't help wondering whether there's an element of misogyny in that. In other words, because the president-elect is a female and her son was killed, therefore she's going to allow her emotions to sway her behavior. Would they have made the same conclusion if she'd been a male? Or would they have had a male president act with self-righteous anger and want revenge against the people that he thought were his enemies? It's not clear to me at this stage which way they're going to go with the president, but I did think it was interesting that Dara Dol is assuming that all of her motivations are emotional motivations and they're not rational. For instance, he can't see that she may genuinely be in favour of a non-military solution in Syria. Adding to his characterization as a caricature is his encounter with the female Israeli operative. He tells her that he doesn't want a contact report for the meeting and that she can share the information with Misha Gavron in person in Tel Aviv.
What do you want me to tell Misha? What's the time factor?
We have very little. 8 weeks at the most. After the inauguration, I expect our hands are going to be tied.
Well, we better get a move on then.
That last exchange was kind of over the top caricature as well. He might as well have said, We're fast running out of time. We must accelerate our plans. Which is actually basically what he said. So in terms of predictions for the season, for Carrie, I'm not sure yet whether or not they're going to do their usual thing of making her look together in the first episode, ripping her completely apart and then building her back up again, or whether or not she's going to be a fairly stable together personality during the season. So that's going to be interesting to see. With Quinn, it's really encouraging that on IMDb he's listed as the second character. I think the actor must be really enjoying himself. He's getting the chance to act the hell out of a role, whereas last season he seemed to spend a lot of time unconscious, injured and in bed, and not in a good way. I can't predict how much of a recovery he's going to make, but I would predict that it has to be significant enough that he's still got, you know, the badass quality about him that's made him popular as a character. It would be quite counterproductive if they keep him as this sort of childlike hobo with rage issues. With Madame Prez, again, as I mentioned, I'm not sure which way they're going to go with her, whether or not she's going to become evil or whether or not she's going to be the voice of reason. It's too early to say. Dara Dahl is probably going to remain evil. I can't imagine they're going to give him much of a character arc. Saul, it's clear to me that they're putting him on a redemption path and they want him to be, you know, Papa Bear again. General McClendon, who's played by Robert Nepper, who was the evil teabag in Prison Break, is probably going to be another villain because I just can't imagine him in any role where he's not a villain. Ray Conlon, I can't tell whether or not he's going to remain adversarial or whether or not he eventually becomes an ally. Rita Hashem, probably just a minor character, but I thought he was quite interesting, so it would be good to have him around. Let's hope they don't kill him off. Sekou Bah, let us hope he doesn't go down the same path as Ayaan. I really hope that they don't kill him off just for emotional scenes and growth for Carrie. Like I said, he is their exploration of racial profiling. I'll post an article that was in The Guardian recently that was written by the actor Riz Ahmed, who is frequently the target of racial profiling at airport searches. So I'm guessing that they're going to be exploring the effect of political victimisation on the likes of a young man like Sekou Bah. Or Sekou Bah. I'm not quite sure how to pronounce his name, sorry. Otto, I assume he's going to come back later on in the season. Not quite sure how, but hopefully it's something meaningful and not just to make rather creepy puppy dog eyes at Carrie. Franny, we've only just caught a glimpse of her, so I'm not quite sure what's going to happen with her, although I have seen some spoilers, but we'll see what happens there. Let's hope this is the last we've seen of Clarence, the most irresponsible hospital ward orderly we've ever met, and also Nurse Batitude. While she had some things of merit to say, overall her bedside manner was appalling. There was also Sekou's best friend. We were not sure whether or not he was perhaps setting up Sekou for some sort of fall. Let's hope he doesn't go down the route of the best friend from last season and end up dying. But I'm imagining he has a larger role to play. Anyway, that's it for the first podcast of the season. If you managed to listen to it all the way through to the end, congratulations on enduring an Australian accent for that long. Let me know if you have any questions or if there's anything that you want me to address. Search for those wings there.